Thank you for inviting me here. I'm not sure or I'm competent, do I be competent to speak about education? Therefore, I prepared an artist presentation because I'm competent only about my work of art. And if I'm invited here, I think because normally I do a workshop here at this time, and because now we are here, so they invited me to do a presentation. The workshop is called Energy Yes, Quality No. It's a critical workshop I do for 1 month here. I started 2.5 weeks ago, and I will stay 1.5 week more. And the idea is that everybody, not only artists, can bring something they are author of, a contribution, a song, a drawing, a painting, a tattoo, a movement, and then together we discuss this and we judge it. We judge it after, is there energy inside? And then it's a yes, or is it only quality? And then it's a no. And so far, about 250 different objects or songs or poetries we discussed and judged together. The idea of this is that energy is something I think is important, an important to me, an important criteria. It's to me a horizontal criteria, because it can be bad energy, good energy, negative, positive. And also it's unstable, and quality seems to me more exclusive, always vertical, go to the top from the low quality. Thank you. So now this lecture, I want to show you some pictures and some terms who are important to me. The first tool, yes, to me, art is a tool. Art is a tool to encounter the world. By the way, I'm here, I'm very happy, it's first time in India. A little bit more than 1 year ago, Anita Dupe came to my studio in Paris and invited me to come to Kochi. So that's the first thing I want. Yes, with my work, through my work, encounter the world. Second thing, I want to use art as a tool to touch reality, my reality, our reality. And third thing, I want to use art as a tool to live in the time I'm inside today. I started to work with, and therefore the question of materiality is important to me as well, to work with very simple materials, cardboard, wood, tape, silver paper, plastic, things they did surround me, normally waste, things they have no plus-value, no artistic plus-value, things they are disponible. I wanted to work with this material in order to include the people and to not exclude it through the material. And since 30 years, I'm working more or less with these materials, and I need to be truthful to it. So one question was always how to do with this quite small element, a kind of a bigger picture. This is one of my first exhibition I did. Another one, to try to put all them together and again to challenge them in a bigger frame here in a studio in the 90s in Paris. Something very important to me was always to work in public space. Since the beginning, I wanted to work in galleries, in museums, wherever people invite me, but also in public space. I decided that there's a very important part of my work, the public space. Why? Just because in the public space, I think it's the artist who can decide the place where the work should be. There's some early works. The work here for me is this paper with the collage on it, or here, the cardboard in front of the other cardboard. So these works, I call them abandoned works. There were some testimony of my first works in public space. This was under a whipper on cars surrounding a place in Paris. And then I started to do kind of altars for a beloved person. This was an altar of Ingeborg Bachmann, a writer, an Austrian writer. Or here, another altar in for Piet Mondrian, the painter. So far, I did 70 works in public space. So sometimes nobody saw them. Sometimes nobody remarked them as art. Because also, I think what is interesting in public space is the conflict, and it's also to challenge the value of art. So then more and more, I wanted to implicate in public space first persons and people. And I call this presence and production. It's my term, so my term is not community art. I don't do community art. I don't do educational art or aesthetical relational art. I call it presence and production because I want that people are present and producing. So the first what I have to do is myself, I thought, to be present and to produce. So this is one of the examples, one of the first, 2002, the Bataille Monument, then another one, 2004, the Musée Précaire Albinet with my neighbors in Paris, in Aubervilliers, in the suburb of Paris, and another one in Amsterdam, it's called the Bijlmer. The Bijlmer is an outskirt of Amsterdam, the Bijlmer Spinoza Festival, together with residents. So when I do this, I ask for help. This is a corner point for me. I'm not coming and saying, I will help you, I can help you. No, it's different. I go there and I say, okay, I'm an artist, I have a project, but I cannot do it alone. I need help. I need your help. And if there is no help, of course, I cannot do it. And only when somebody is helping me, I can do the artwork. So this happened. This is my last big project, 2013, the Gramsci Monument I did, produced by a big art foundation, DIA Art Foundation in New York. So I met Clyde Thompson. Clyde Thompson is a social worker in South Bronx Forest Houses. First meeting, I presented him my project and he asked me, what will be the benefit for our community? And I said, I don't know, because I don't work for your community. I'm working for art. And this was a very good discussion, I think, because he understood that me as an artist, I need to work for art. But he as a social worker needed to work for his community. So because he understood it, we decided together to do the Gramsci Monument, where he is working in Forest Houses, South Bronx. So then together with 15 residents of Forest Houses, we built in about 6 weeks the platform, the elements, the different pavilions of this Gramsci Monument. I wanted, it was my idea to do a monument for the philosopher, the communist thinker and philosopher, Antonio Gramsci, because I love his writings and his thinking, like the phrase destruction is difficult, it is indeed as difficult as creation, or also Gramsci declared every human being is an intellectual. And for this and other reasons, I decided to do this work, and then we, together with the neighborhood, we established daily and weekly events, like a running event with the local hip-hoppers, or then in this monument, there was of course a library with books about and from Antonio Gramsci. Then we had a small radio station, a low-power radio station, to spread out news from the neighborhood, but also about Gramsci and invited people. Then every week we get real specialists about Gramsci. This is Frank Wilderson, a specialist about Gramsci and a scholar about Gramsci, who came to speak about the philosopher Gramsci. Then also we had an everyday lecture about philosophy from a German philosopher. And the same workshop, energy yes, quality no, this critical workshop I did also in the Bronx for the people who were there, and people could come and bring something, and we discussed it and judged it. Something else I did long time ago. I did a map of my own work, which goes in a direction, which what is important for me, what helps me, what encourages me, what is the problematic to me, and also what is the danger. So I thought it's a good thing to do a map. Everybody can do it for the position, to take a position. Therefore, I call it, where do I stand? What do I want? What is nice when you do a map, I think, it's not everything is perhaps on the right place, but everything is necessary. If not, I don't do it on the map. Perhaps there are lacks of things, or because this map is not the newest one, something can be added, but everything which is on the map is necessary to me. Then I do also bigger sculptural work, but also kind of precarious work. This was for a kind of biennale. It's called Manifesta. This was in St. Petersburg, 214. It's also, everything is done with cardboard, tape, wood. It's called Abschlag, means a cut off of a facade. I decided to do it in this strange kind of inside-outside building of the Hermitage Museum. A kind of doubt came up. Is this new? Is this old? Is this fake? Is this real? And therefore, I do my work. I construct between two existing buildings a kind of facade. And in this facade, on the top of the facade, there were some apartments, and because there was a cut-up of the facade, inside, we could look inside of the facade, and in five of them, I could exhibit original artwork of the, from me beloved, Russian constructivist. This is a Malevich. There was two Rozanova and two Filonov paintings. So to me, it was also my work. There was also a homage to this heritage of the Russian constructivists. So something very important to me is that the collage, the thinking of collage, but also the technique of collage. To me, to do a collage means to take two things from the existing world and to put them together. Two things, they have nothing to do. But because I put them together, now they are together, and there is a new world exist. Like, this is an older one. It's called Ur-Collage, Collage d'origine. I made a series of them. And more recently, I made this kind of collage. I call it pixel collage, where there is a third element. There is always two elements. One from a fashion magazine and one from the a print from the internet, and I glue them together, and then with the third element, with the pixels, I try to make a link through the colors between both elements. There are small ones, you can see it on the left side, and then I did also some bigger ones, like you can see here on the right, or even here, very big one. But I didn't want to blow up them. Every collage is made with A3 on a home printer myself. I printed it in my studio and taped it together. So it's also the technical for collage. And what I wanted is, in a way, that there is no scale. Therefore, they are smalls, but also very big ones. And the big ones, I made it for the size of the existing wall. here in an exhibition in New York. In order to break the scale, to make it possible, to that the thinking there is no scale in a way, I made the big and the small ones. So it was mentioned before that, yes, one term I am interested is the one of the non-exclusive audience. I made this schema. This is a schema for myself, the artist. The important thing is that me as an artist, I'm not directing my work to what I call the spectrum of evaluation. The institution director, the art critic, the art lover, the collector, the gallerist, etc. What I think is important, I direct my work to the other, what I call the non-exclusive, the whom who has other problems than art, the whom who is not interested in art. I mean, this is just a dynamic, but I think if I do this dynamic, if I follow this dynamic, I have a chance to touch the modestly, but I have a chance to touch the non-exclusive audience. If I direct my work only to the center or the spectrum of evaluation, I think I have no chance to touch the other, the non-exclusive audience. Therefore, this gives me a direction. So I did a work, my another work, also presence and production, but this was not in public space because outcoming of public space, I thought I can also do it in an institution. So therefore, I made in Saskatchewan. That is in it's in Canada. I was invited by a very new museum, Rime Modern, to do a work. And for 1 month, I did there also another kind of critical workshop. It's called "What Can I Learn from You? What Can You Learn from Me?" And the idea what people can come and share a competence they have with each other. So people came and told us how to cook, or other people came and explained some traditional items, or artists from the surrounding came and explained their way how to implicate through art the residents or the surrounding. I just wanted to mention, to me as an artist, was always very important to write about my work critically. Since the beginning, I did it. If there is an advice to give to a young artist, that's the only one I could give. Write about your work. I wrote a lot. I have no pretension to be a theoretician. I have no pretension to be a writer. But because my competence is my work, I can write about. I can fix things. I can use my own term instead to use the term of art history or art critic. I can explain things to the other, and also I can clarify things, and also sometimes I can give my very own testimony of things. Here I just wrote, why do I think what I think, why do I do what I do, art, why I use the instrument I use, and why I use the form I use. So the last picture shows how I understand myself as artist, of course, because I love art. It helped me to emancipate myself. Art, through art, I emancipated myself through art. I am a worker, because I'm not a star, I'm not a prince or a princess, I'm not whatever, I'm a worker. I am a producer, I'm working, I love to work, and I'm a soldier. I'm fighting for my work. I have to fight still, always, for my work, for my vision of art and for art. Therefore, yes, I am an artist, worker, soldier. Thank you.
So you mentioned that you'd done the same project in New York as well. So what kind of role do you play? Is it, does it pan out as a debate? Does it pan out as a, you know, something people agree on? Do you play a moderator in the group, or what's your role when the others are expressing their views on the artwork?
Yes, my role is a little bit ambiguous because I'm an animator. I'm an animator, so I try to animate. To animate the circle. We are sitting in a circle. So, for example, I myself, I give also my judgment. And of course, I don't show every time a work of mine, so I told the people, you can judge the whole thing. So I'm not participating in the same way. But I'm an animator because, first of all, I love to look to things precisely and to try to get the energy of it. And I want to give an example, just how I see it, in order to encourage the others also. So therefore, it's a little bit ambiguous. But still, I think it's what I can give. I want not be only the organizer of it. So I'm a participant. Then I try also to be the judge of time, that everybody has more or less the same time, because I want that is equal. So if we are more people, we have more time, or we are less people, we have less time. So what we do then is also, and I try also to encourage the person not to speak about their work, just to present, or whatever their contribution, just to present it, and just after, in the end, to explain why, etc., the context of it, in order that we are really free just to get to feel, to show, to see, or to touch the energy coming out of something. So therefore, I'm a kind of animator, and of course a kind of also a kind of guard or guide. For example, I always try to explain, we are never judging the person, but we are judging the thing, the element, the painting, or the song, or the poem. And that must be a distinction. So I must be attentive that we're never judging the person, for example, but only what we see. So this is my role.
Hello, yeah. I was just wondering, when you talk about help, how do you decide from whom to take help?
No, just a moment. I don't decide. For example, in the Bronx, what I did, how I proceeded. I went to 44. I mean, the only thing I decided, I wanted to do my monument where people are living. So I decided only, I wanted to do my monument where people are living. So I went to New York, and in New York, 500,000 New Yorkers lives in public housings. There is a map, it's called, there is an organization, the New York City Public Housing. And they have a map, and there are more than 250 public housings all over in New York, in five boroughs of New York. So I went to 44, but in all of the boroughs, and I engaged, it's very simple, just go to the social workers. You know, they are there and say, hello, I'm an artist. And I went to 44, and then sometimes people said me, do you have the permission to do it, for example, you know? But he didn't ask me this, you know? So, and then you feel some, because it starts with a human relation. And I didn't decide, he decided, you know, for me. He said, yeah, Thomas, we will do it with you, you know, but not alone. He discussed with his friends and the youngsters he take care on, and with other people, the residents of forest houses. So it's not that I'm choosing, they choose me then in a way. So therefore, I went to a lot, and I mean, it was a work for about, I was there 11 times in New York, always 10 to 2 weeks in order to find somebody who is working with me. So this is a very important work. I call it field work. It's a very, very important work.
this another, you showed two, in the beginning there was this series on the abandoned, like leaving the artwork and not deciding who will watch it or how it will be watched. It was left on the pavement or on the roadside. You kept the work. And then you have moved into this kind of a conversation where you are trying to work together with some group of people or whoever is interested to help you. Or so how is there a kind of a shift that happened in your practice?
Yes. So then, you know, very realistically, if I can here, you know, what worked. So after Clyde said, okay, we will help you. So then, because Clyde, he cannot help me really every day because he was there in his office. He has to be in the office every day. And then one day, I mean, I was there six times because I liked the conversation with him. And I liked very much that he understood when I said, I'm working for art. And he had really, he thought this is really good for him. He said, this is interesting that you didn't say I want to work for community. He said, yes, it interests me that you're coming and say you're working for art. And then I told him always, but I need somebody who is every time with me. And then I was very lucky because once after six time I was there, and then he told me, look, I want to that you encounter this person. He's Eric Farmer. And he was a resident there. And he got the key figure for me in this project. Because then he was agree, I mean, he discussed before with Clyde and with me, then he said, okay, we do it, I will help you every day really on the ground. And then he constituted, I said, I need help. So, and then we constituted the team. He constituted the team. The people were paid by the Out Art Foundation, of course, for their help. But it was the team. So the all of the team were residents. And he constituted the team, and we worked together. And I want just to add something. You know, to me, as artist, not to pretend to make social work is very important. It can be very, very helpful. When? In the moments of crisis. In the moment of crisis, my only competence is art. The competence of the other is the social work. So we have a different way to react, and that's very good. It's very but there was never, for example, never a competition. There was kind of conflict, but it's a loyal conflict because I was always clear, I'm an artist, I'm working for art. I am not a social worker. And this is a kind of interesting conflict, I think, for both sides. So it needs, I tell you just, you know, it needs clarity also from the side of the artist. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I mean, the art education. I mean, I don't know. I don't know, I tried to offer the tools to education in books, in lectures, as I told you, in dialogues together. We organized events, we organized different events, also coming from the initiatives coming from the neighborhood. So I was then the organizer of these events. And we had also, I had no picture here, but we had also a children program for the kids, but it was more, it was every day. The children are very important, I think, because they were like the beginning in the morning. They were there very early in the morning to be there and to have a children program. So, I mean, the educational part, you know, how can I say? I see it in the whole. You know, I was happy when somebody said, for example, we meet at the Gramsci sculpture without knowing Gramsci, just telling Gramsci, saying a Gramsci, you know? So the main goal was not the education to me. The main goal was to make a monument for Antonio Gramsci. Yes, yes, absolutely. I forget to say, all my 70 works in public space are precarious. Temporary. It's very important to me. I love precariousness. I love this kind of temporary works. Why? Because, of course, we built this hall. But then we dismantle it. And why? Because we are not, I mean, I am not linked to the object. What happened, what I want with this, with what I wanted with this, is to make an experience, to make a moment of density, of charge, of grace, perhaps, which is this sustainable. The moment, not the, to have, not the object. This is my understanding of sculpture in public space. To make a moment so dense, so in a way, so intense, that these moments are sustainable moments and are eternal moments, and not the object one. So therefore, I call it also a monument, because it's a monument, what is an affirmation of a monument today, not as a sculpture who wants to be there for every time, but as something who, in at one moment, creates intensity.
I was just thinking that since you have worked on Antonio Gramsci, George Bataille, and they were latest to us, Deleuze, if I'm not wrong, right? So all of these philosophers also have some kind of notions about precarity or you know, something that about transgression, about excess, about non-linearity and so on. So while you choose the locations or the community, is there anything that particularly you look that have some correspondence with any of these philosophical propositions or the larger philosophical foundations of or anti-foundations of these philosophers?
Yeah, it was important to me that in a way there was no context. And mostly people in forest houses told me we didn't heard about Antonio Gramsci. But you know what was really good discussion then, of course, they heard about Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, of course, which are, for example, Malcolm X not so far away in the thinking and also in the everyday life. But then, you know, it's very important to, and it was always very good to discuss, but I cannot come, it's not my idea to go to the Bronx and say, I make for you a Malcolm X monument. No, I wanted really to do a monument for Antonio Gramsci, and then there were these people there were so keen to welcome me to do it there. And then, of course, we worked out links. And in America, in New York also, but also Gramsci is quite known, and also abroad. So I brought, I tried to brought these people with me to that they explain why Gramsci and what was the achievement and what is was the questions and why he is so an important philosopher. But it was very important that also in other works I did, that there is not a context. The context is made through the moment there and now and through this combination between the idea of an artist and between the people who helped the artist to do this.
No, what I meant is that there is definitely that as an artist that if you are doing a monument, you know, this monument is also not like a conventional monument. It is also a precarious monument. It is a monument that is not meant for, you know, commemorate something in a an abstract or in a what is the word for it? In a rhetorical way, in that sense. So, in that sense, if you if I am if as an artist, if you are looking at a monument, And I think it is also equally important to know the kind of political history or the philosophical genealogy of a place, wherein which while you organize anything around Gramsci, for instance, like you are mentioning about Martin Luther King or Malcolm X or whatever. So what kind of a network that you create, for instance, to have some kind of a resonance with the core political or philosophical ideas about Gramsci, for that matter. For that matter, you need to have some kind of a understanding about the community, the kind of political history of that community, the community's own political struggle, and so on. That's what I meant.
Yeah. I think I understood. There was there was a counter hegemony, which I thought very, very interesting. Small manifestations of people who brought magazines, because they thought these books, they're not speaking to us. So residents came up with kind of, I have not the picture here, with kind of incredible magazines to show what could be an interest of. Completely initiative of counter-hegemony. I thought very interesting. Look, I mean, that's my idea of a monument. Not to do a monument there because the person was killed there, or he or she came from this place, or there are there something specific happened related to the person. But just to declare it as something universal. And therefore, it's very important to me that I made four monuments for Spinoza, for Gramsci, for Deleuze, and for Bataille. There are four, only four. And all of them are not really related to the space. The first one, yes, the Spinoza monument, because it was in Amsterdam, but the other three, because I learned that it is not necessary to do. And then I thought it's interesting also when there is no real link. But there are, and that's the beauty, I think, there are some moments of grace. For example, when I went to my research in New York, I didn't know, but there is at the CUNY University, not far away from the South Bronx, there is an archive with more than 2,000 books of Antonio Gramsci. It's in the American Italian Society, and they legated it to the CUNY University. So I asked them to lend it. And by the way, just Gayatri Spivak was Mrs. Spivak. Perhaps you know her. Here she also came and gave one of the talks about Antonio Gramsci. I just wanted. So there were input, and there were people. There were input, and there were people who I think, for example, through the prison experience, a lot of people, young people, 40% of the young people in the Bronx have, unfortunately, already a prison experience. So there were links we could discuss together. But I wanted that this is more, how can I say, graceful. I didn't want to say organic, you know, by chance.
So you worked in a predominantly black neighborhood, I'm assuming, when you did your Gramsci monument, right?
Yes, of course.
So right now you said that Malcolm X was not that much of an interest for you. You were more interested in having this monument dedicated to Gramsci. But I was wondering, you're working with this community of predominantly black people, and they have this, why not have a conversation between maybe Malcolm X and Antonio Gramsci, you know, in a way, because when you look at black history and, you know, the kind of movement that that in New York and Bronx and, you know, the kind of history they have with Malcolm X, I thought, you know, it was very interesting that you talk about Antonio Gramsci, but, I mean, not really invest in something that the community has a very deep personal history with. I mean, that is just a comment.
Yeah, I just wanted to extend. It was not, it was half-half, black and Puerto Rican, half-half. By the way, I made here, you see, all the people here are, we can call Afro-Americans, the team, because it was Eric who made the team. So I had always a lot to learn as artist. I learn. And by the way, therefore it's very important also to be on the ground and to understand. So I didn't got that he is, he brings me 15. I asked for 15 helpers, and all was African Americans. And then I saw, oh, what happened now? Because on the street, I mean, there are also Puerto Rican, a lot, because it's statistically 50-50, more or less, even a little bit more Puerto Rican. Very few white people, very few Asian people, but more or less 50-50. And then, and therefore, it is good to be an artist sometimes, and to need then to, it's just because you mentioned this. It's not about a kind of disinterest, but what I can really do, what I must do as the artist, you know, not as the white, as the artist. I saw this, and then of course I had discussion with him, and then he said, yeah, but I cannot reach them out. They're not coming with me. They're not, I cannot speak to them. I mean, it's not a big thing, but he just told me that he needed help. And then I did it myself. I went to one-to-one implicate the Puerto Rican community, who has less street presence than there in the Bronx, than the African American. And then the team was completely mixed. So I had to do it, for example. It was my work to do. I know this is not responding to your question, but so it was helpful to be there and to understand what's going on. And so it's not that I didn't want care about what happened in this community. I was aware about, and I challenged either his capacity, but also then my capacity to make this in a way not visible, but truthful, the engagement of the whole community and not only of a part community. This was a lecture I had, and always you have when you do, I think, art in public space. It's a big challenge for me. It was a big challenge for me here. Always I do projects like this. I had big challenges to encounter. Now I do a big challenge project in Switzerland with my home country. The biggest challenge in Switzerland is these people, they need for everything a permission to do. So they are completely self-neutralizing them all the time. That's my big challenge there. In Paris, when you work with a kind of a community in a suburb, there are other challenges to confront.